JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for June the 11th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar was found higher against most of the other G10 currencies during the early European morning Thursday. It was lower only against the safe havens franc and yen, while it was found virtually unchanged against euro. The greenback gained the most versus NOK, AUD and NZD in that order. The strengthening of the safe havens franc, yen and dollar, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked Aussie and Kiwi, suggests that markets continued trading in a risk-off manner yesterday and during the Asian morning today. Indeed, turning our gaze to the equity world, we see that the majority of global stock indices finished their trading sessions in negative waters. The exception was Nasdaq, which hit a new record high, closing above the 10,000 mark for the first time in its history. The market impact of yesterday's main event, the Fed's decision, did not last for long. Ahead of the announcement, EU stocks continued sliding as investors kept locking profits. At the time of the decision, US stocks inched higher and the dollar slid, but this was only temporary. It seems that investors continued with profit-taking post the decision, despite the Fed appearing dovish. The committee kept interest rates unchanged and noted that they will continue to increase bonds and mortgage bank securities, at least at the current pace, something suggesting that purchases can accelerate again if deemed necessary. The committee will closely monitor developments and is prepared to adjust its plans as appropriate, it was noted in the accompanying statement. With regards to the new dot plot, the median dots suggested that interest rates are likely to stay at the current level at least until 2022, with members agreeing unanimously that the rates should stay untouched until the end of 2021. Only two of them are seeing increases in 2022. We are not even thinking about raising rates, Fed Chair Powell characteristically said at the press conference following the decision. As far as the economic projections are concerned, officials projected a 6.5% tumble in GDP for this year and a 5% rebound next year. They see the unemployment rate at 9.3% at the end of the year and core PC inflation at 1% year over year. As for our view, it has not changed even after the FOMC decision. On the contrary, the Fed's readiness to expand its stimulus efforts if things fall out of orbit is a positive for stocks and a negative for the dollar, in our view. Yes, investors appear to have continued locking profits after the recent steep surge in equities, but we don't expect this to last for long. Eventually, the continued easing of the lockdown measures, combined with more data suggesting that the worst with regards to the coronavirus is behind us, may allow investors to increase their risk exposures again. This means higher equities and risk-linked currencies, as well as lower safe havens. Among currency pairs, we think that the ones consisting of a risk-linked currency and a safe haven will turn north again. Some of those pairs are Aussie dollar, Kiwi dollar, Aussie yen and Kiwi yen. Now, as for today's events, during the European morning, Sweden's inflation numbers for May are due to be released. Both the CPI and CPIF rates are forecast to have remained unchanged at minus 0.4% year over year, but as it is always the case, we prefer to pay more attention to the core CPIF rate, which excludes energy. That rate slid to 1% year over year in April from 1.5% in March. When they last met, Riksbank policymakers decided to continue purchases of government and mortgage bonds up to the end of September 2020 and to leave the repo rate unchanged at 0%. They also said that the measures will be adjusted to economic developments. Thus, a potential rebound in the core CPIF metric may raise some speculation that the world's oldest central bank may start scaling back its QE at some point soon. From the US, we get the PPIs for May and the initial jobless claims for last week. The headline PPI rate is forecast to have declined to minus 1.3% year over year from 1.2%, while the core one is anticipated to have slid to 0.4% from 0.6%. With regards to initial jobless claims, they are expected to have slowed further to 1.55 million from 1.87 million the week before. Apart from the data, we also have an EU finance ministers meeting where ministers are expected to discuss a coronavirus rescue fund. The euro traded on a fly mode recently, perhaps due to the announcement by the EU Commission over a 750 billion euros rescue plan, and an official approval may keep the currency supported. On the other hand, a failure to seal an anchor over the aforementioned proposal may prompt some euro bulls to liquidate their positions and force the common currency to correct lower. As for tonight, during the Asian morning Friday, Japan's final industrial production for April is due to be released, with the forecast expected to confirm the preliminary print of minus 9.1% month over month. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.